Transactions we've had from startups, from the perspective of the startups, as well as from the perspective of capital, venture capital funds. In the next hour and a half or so, what I'm trying to do is, you know, trying to make all of you aware of some of the compliances that are required under the Companies Act. All points. I think most of you are associated with companies, or is there any other sort of structure that you would like to know about? My presentation is
good. I would like to know more about relationship with the company as an individual.
Sure. So I'll be covering that from a compliance perspective. I'll also be covering a lot in terms of what happens in terms of a funding transaction. What are sort of the areas that, you know, typically startups struggle with? In my experience, what are the sort of areas that investors and funding managers look at course of a funding transaction, and what is, you know, sort of to be looked at, complied with over the next 90 minutes or so.
I think there is one thing which I come across with a lot of people whom I interact with, especially the youngsters who are looking at starting up. The question is, you know, should they be incorporating right at day one, or they should be waiting for some time? The ideal thing is you have some traction coming in, you are actually clear with where you are heading. That's the right time to incorporate. But there is another side of argument as well, you know, if you get things up and running right from day one. So, you know, that is something which is always a catch-22 situation for
absolutely. And in fact, I'll start with that, because that is the first stage that any sort of startup would come from. And I think the first thing that I'll tell you is that it's always better to incorporate an entity first. And next, incorporation these days does not require a lot of cost, it does not require a lot of time, and it does not require a lot of effort. The Ministry of Corporate Affairs has their own website now. Most of the filings and documentation is done online, and it is basically, I mean, we've incorporated companies in about 4 and 5 days for our clients. So it's not a big hassle. The reason why I say is start with incorporating is because the whatever little or big assets that you're going to own, whatever business that you're going to be doing, whatever revenue that is going to be coming, if the eventual intention is to transfer it to an incorporated entity, then it's better to start off with the entity itself. It becomes a sort of a headache if you start it in an individual name and then you need to transfer it back to a company. It's an extra legal step. Any business, if someone comes to me for an advice, there's no right or wrong, it's just advisable to do what it is. It is better to do it in the name of a company because your liability as an individual is limited. A company being recognized as a separate legal person, if there's any liability, will be on the company. If you do it as an individual, any liability will be on the name of the individual. If you even do it as, under the old Indian partnership, the Partnership Act, it's still on an individual. In 2008, we developed a new vehicle and named legal system called as the LLP. The LLP is very similar to a company in the sense that liability is again on the entity, separate legal person. But going forward, having worked with a lot of funds, they are more comfortable at the moment to invest in companies than in LLCs. Partnership and individuals for funding is so the advisable to answer your question. So the advisable way is to incorporate an entity and start off so that all the business is carried out in the name of the entity. If the eventual intention is to have an entity name, there certain individuals who prefer have been sole proprietors and work as sole proprietors throughout. But there are a lot of restrictions in that. And in fact, as I said, there's no right or wrong, but the advisable part is never to be a sole proprietor.
This is usually happens when there are a couple of people involved, a couple of co-founders. entrepreneurs coming together.
Right.
The initial few months you are all charged up, that's the honeymoon period.
Sure.
When you actually start hitting the ground, things don't turn up. That's
right.
When the dispute starts. So when you have incorporated a company, challenges of giving the right way of exiting, you know, all these things crop up at a later stage.
Sure.
You are not prepared for it. So
right.
So that was the perspective.
From a legal perspective, it's always advisable, even in that sense, to have a company. Let's say you have a partnership, because the example that you've given is there are two people there.
Absolutely.
And let's take an example where there's a partnership. The issue of exit is going to come even at that point of time. How you're going to exit is even more at that point of time. God forbid if there's something wrong that has actually happened. In that scenario, the liability will be entirely on you. But under a company, the liability is going to on the company. Individually, you can still sort of get away. I know, I mean, in more theoretical, practical sense, you
absolutely
still have to sort of. But Let's assume hypothetically as a scenario where as a partnership you are looking for some working capital loans. You go to banks and financial institutions. First of all, because the partnership is always a little bit of gray, because the reason that I said that a partnership is more individual driven, a company is a corporate entity. Easier for banks to sort of do KYC and stuff. But let's assume a scenario where a partnership is availed of a working capital loan, and let's assume a scenario where a company is availed of a working capital loan. And then go to the scenario that you spoke about where things don't work out and finally give it an entity here. That loan has to be settled by individuals. Under the company, the loan is on the head of the company. Now the individuals will have to make efforts to settle it, but through the assets of the company.
Mm.
In this case, the liability is going to come to you, to your assets, to your personal assets.
Mm.
So, you know, very fundamentally, at a very basic stage, whenever people come up, and this is a question actually asked very often when you know, the so-called founders come together, what do we do? What is the entity that we should look at? And of course, there are three or four follow-up questions that I will ask to gauge the intention of the founders. But once the intention is sort of, the advice is always that it's preferable to have a private limited company than to have any other event. This legal foundation of a private limited company is much more solid in all scenarios than it is of a partner.
So not even an LLP.
An LLP is a solid fund, except that because the LLP Act got incorporated in India in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
So that LLP as a vehicle is still, you know, we're still accepting it. For a long time, a lot of these legislations, you know, where you have to like take boxes, fill in forms and say, are you an individual, are you a partnership, or are you a company, did not even have a box for an LLP.
True.
It changed now. The way the LLP structure, you know, works is that very similar to partnership, partners enter into an agreement, you know, to have contractual terms and conditions and profits and all. VC funds, private equity funds, which eventually all of you will be hoping to get into, don't like that structure. They like to have a private company where they're given certain instruments or shares or preference shares. They like to have sort of rights as board members. They like to have rights as, you know, exiting. You know, they like to have the option of an IPO at some future date. So in terms of fundraising, an LLP is still not looked upon very few.
Private equity is the way forward.
I mean, as I said, that would be my advice to everyone to have a private equity. Right. So, as I said, to begin with, you know, I'll just sort of deal with the compliance angle of it, and then go to the sort of practical issues with respect to fundraising and what fundraising. You know, for a long time in India, we had what was the driving legislation for companies was the Companies Act of 1956. That was the fundamentally principled legislation that was in India for a very long time. Around 2000, a year before that, the legislators sort of decided we needed to have a Companies Act which was more in tune with the modern business times. Not much happened about it. Late 2000, we had various camps in India, you know, sort of made legislators push for new legislation. And so the Companies Act 2013 came into effect in around October 2013. When the Companies Act 2013 came into effect, a lot of the private companies, you know, started sweating because the amount of compliances that were prescribed for private companies in the eventual, in the initial act was very similar to the public companies. So you had actually no real significant difference between how a private company functioned and a public company functioned in terms of compliances. There were of course differences in terms of capital requirements, stuff like that, but most of the private companies, startups is a sort of a relatively modern term, but most of the people who had, you know, started new companies were sweating because everything that was expected from a large public company was now expected from them when this act first came into effect. So a lot of compliances, say Infosys was doing at their holding company level, were at that stage required from a small private company as well. Eventually, you know, a lot of discussions, you know, drafts of amendments and, you know, to and fro comments from stakeholders eventually resulted in around 2015 June for the government to come out with an amendment to the Companies Act. And fortunately, a lot of the compliance requirements that were expected from private company were relaxed. So we went back very similar to the old act where private companies were virtually sort of, you know, small entities not having that many stringent compliance requirements. Even now, companies still have some compliance requirements which are very, you know, necessary for them to sort of move forward. Some of you may be aware of this, some of you might think this is fairly basic, but in my experience very often I've seen a lot of founders not aware of these things. And that's the reason why I'm sort of, you know, coming to this. One of the most basic requirement is the holding of board meetings in a private limited company. The Act makes it mandatory for 4 board meetings to be held every year. And if you don't hold these board meetings, there are fines that the Companies Act prescribes. Shareholder meeting, popularly known as also as annual general meeting, there's a requirement of holding at least 1 annual general meeting every year. For extraordinary circumstances, you can of course call upon an extraordinary annual general meeting. Excuse me. The Act has sort of requirements in terms of notices to be given for conveying of the meeting. There's a time period of conveying or issuing notices, but the critical part, of course, is to hold these meetings as prescribed under the Act. Share certificates, very critical. For some of you, this might sound very funny, but I've actually had clients have come up to me and said, we are holding X number of shares in the company, startups, and I asked them, okay, so I want to have a look at your share certificates, and then there's been a blank expression on their face. Under companies that if you don't hold share certificates, you don't hold shares in the company. You need to hold. So you incorporate an entity, you incorporate a company. There has to be a document evidencing how many shares you're holding in that entity. You know, verbally, it's no good saying verbally I hold 80% in my company. There has to be a document evidencing that. And without that document, it's not much good saying that you hold X number of shares. There's a procedure for appointment of directors. Directors need to be sort of, every appointment of a director needs to be confirmed by the shareholders at an annual general meeting. Till the time a shareholder confirms the appointment, for a period of 3 months, a director can function as a director. The term used then is an additional director, but you know the term is regularized. His appointment is regularized only when shareholders sort of confirm that. So till the time a shareholder confirms that in a shareholder meeting, a director is not recognized as a regular director of a company. There are now requirements. You know, I'm sure if you sort of interact with your company secretaries, there are requirements of filing certain forms on the Ministry of Corporate Affairs website. By the way, everybody aware of the MCA website? What the MCA website is? The Ministry of Corporate Affairs website actually holds all the information with respect to your company. So there is certain information that is openly available. If I want to sort of go and search about a company and type the name of the company, there's certain information that is available openly. And there's certain information that I need to pay a little bit amount of money and then I'll get extract of that. So all the records that you now file, in the olden days you needed to go and actually deliver hard copies to the ROC. All the records now are uploaded online. So all the information of all companies, all the information of individuals who are acting as directors is all on the MCA portal. With respect to appointment of directors, there are certain forms that also need to be uploaded, and once those forms are uploaded, the director is recognized as a director of the company. Inflow of money, I'm going to come back to that later in the presentation. Basically, there has to be a very sort of strict mechanism in terms of the money coming into the account of the company. If the money is coming as consideration for allotment of shares, then it needs to be kept in a separate bank account. We will deal with that. But if it is coming as working capital loan, and for working capital purposes, it needs to be kept in the account of the company. Again, an example that I had, you know, two founders thinking that they have a private limited company, but you know, getting all the money in their individual accounts. That's a problem. You cannot have an individual account accepting money for company related purposes. Statutory registers, you know, the Companies Act makes it very mandatory for each company to maintain registers. Your register of all your shareholders is required to be maintained. That is called as a register of members. Your register of your directors is required to be maintained. Your register of the loans that you are aware of is required to be maintained. There are about 14 registers different that are required to be maintained. Everybody knows what a registered office is?
Yeah.
So all these registers are now required under law to be kept in the registered office. It cannot be kept at any office or not. It has to be kept at the registered office.
Just want to check. Is there, compared to the regular private limited for startups, is there minimum documentation and a single window or something which has been announced?
No, startups, under the Companies Act, there is, basically three companies. Public company, there is a private company, four companies, a small company, and there is a one-person company. And the Companies Act does not have a definition of startups as such. Startup definition is coming from a government policy for startups in which there are given exemptions with respect to intellectual property. There are certain tax benefits for a period of 7 years that has been given. But under the Companies Act, whatever compliances are required for a private limited company, whether it's sort of a startup or a bigger sort of private limited, there is no exemption. You have to comply with everything. In a one-person company, there are certain exemptions if you're just one individual. But these, the ones that I have mentioned, in terms of appointment of director, a private limited company requires two directors. For a one-person company, obviously, you can do it with one director. But the others are sort of mandatory for all companies. And these are the basic. I mean, if we study the Companies Act in detail, for a public company, in fact, they're much more stringent compliance.
For these 14 registers you mentioned,
yeah.
You mean specifically you need to maintain?
Yeah, I mean, thing is, a lot of them maintain Excel sheets,
okay.
And if tomorrow there is a reason to sort of for someone to demand, you can always take that out. But at least that record should be there, and then I'll come back to that why those records are required further down. Disclosures. There are
just to interject. You said you need minimum two directors
for a private
company. Now, as a single person, I can still start a private limited company.
You need two shareholders as well. You need two shareholders. What if
the other director doesn't hold any share?
That's fine. No, but you need two shareholders. You can have two shareholders. And you can have a third person as a director, that's fine.
Can you hold 0.01%?
So yeah, so what a lot of people do is they hold 99% and they appoint someone to hold that one first share as a beneficial sort of, so you're actually owning it, but because of the requirement of two shareholders, someone is holding a non-share. Under the 56 Act, there was no provision for a one-person company. Under this Act now, you actually have a provision for one-person companies. So, that is something if you are single, alone in the business, you can.
Is there any requirement of the amount of investment?
Yeah, 1 lakh is the minimum capital amount for a private company.
No, we're talking about a single SPC, single-person company.
Single-person is also 1 lakh.
1 lakh, yeah. And is it easy to actually have additional partners later?
Yeah, of course. I mean, whenever an investor comes in, he will be a shareholder, right? So you'll have to go through the procedure.
That's why I'm asking. Is it difficult to convert a single person to a private limited?
Oh yeah. I'm sorry. I thought you were just talking about it. Yeah, yes. There will be a process that is specified. You see, as an OPC, a one-person company, let's say you form a private limited company, XYZ. The nomenclature is XYZ Private Limited. And your incorporation happens as an XYZ Private Limited. As an OPC, your company will be XYZ OPC. XYZ one-person company. And hence all your filings, recordings and everything will be done under the ambit of an OPC. So you need to convert it. You need to go to the register of companies, convert it. Your entire compliance structure changes. Your articles will have to undergo a change. Articles being the constitutional documents from companies. So all those things will undergo a change. So it will, I wouldn't say that it's a difficult process, but it will be a little bit of a... So if you're at the moment, if the intention is, say, a year down the line, you anyways want to have one more shareholder coming in, it might then be advisable to have one person holding one share and have a proper private limited company so that you avoid all these.
In terms of the cost, if you're talking about an OPC and a private limited, so what is the starting of cost for an OPC and a private limited company?
Private limited minimum capital 1 lakh and OPC also.
No, I'm talking about cost involved in setting up a company. Incorporation cost.
Oh, that I would.
Just an average, it depends on.
It wouldn't be significantly different. If you are keeping the minimum capital. Because the cost for incorporation would be in terms of the fees that you pay to the MCA for name approval and stuff like that. The only way the cost will vary is that if you pay stamp duty on the constitutional documents. And hence the constitutional documents stamp duty will vary on the capital that you have. So in that sense the stamp duty might vary. I can come back to you on the exact figures.
Sure.
Okay, any further questions on this topic?
Why should we come to a lawyer? Why not go to a chartered accountant?
You want to go to a chartered accountant, you feel you go, I can share my experiences.
I mean, there must be, there are pros and cons.
Sir, a lawyer understands law, is what I believe. A chartered accountant understands tax law. If you come to me for tax advice, I myself will go to a chartered accountant. I don't think a chartered accountant understands law as much as well as we do.
There are certain chartered accountants who specialize in
law. They might be better than me. I'm just giving my views on it.
Yeah.
Most of the top, most of the venture capital funds or people who are in this space acquire legal counsels. They don't acquire tax counsels. I mean, they acquire tax counsels for taxes, but for doing the legal bit, they acquire legal counsels. But at the end of the day, I think having worked in Mumbai and having worked in Bangalore and Pune, I think Pune is the only place where I've seen where people have done incorporation by using CS and CAs. They have drafted agreements by using CS and CAs. It's something that I have failed to understand, but it's people
are saying. I think wherever contracts are involved, you need
you
a lawyer. You can't do without a lawyer. You have to have a lawyer. And this is a lawyer talking.
But that's the first time I've been a lawyer, so I
understand.
No,
no. No, but I was ready for all questions. I'm not answering ready for this question. First time I've asked this question. Anyways, disclosures. I think there are certain disclosures that are mandatory under the Companies Act. One being, a term being used which is related party transaction. A related party transaction is if I have a company and if that company is engaged in some kind of a business with another entity which is sort of either I have an interest in or my family has an interest in, then that is a related party transaction. I'll give an example. I have a private limited company which, you know, I think, for instance, so you said you have an online two-wheeler sale. Now you sort of, do you sell two-wheelers online or how do you?
We are a marketplace for two-wheeler services.
Marketplace.
Like we are an aggregator who brings service centers on board online.
Sure.
And provide a platform to the customer.
All right. Just going to we are advising an online aggregator for four-wheelers, which is called Credo. I don't know if you've heard. Yeah. So just to give an example, if you, for instance, if you are engaged, you know, enter into agreement with your brother or someone who is providing spare parts. Or something like that. Just, you know, that's a related party transaction. And disclosures with respect to that is required to be given. There's a related party registered as well, and you need to maintain that. And every related party transaction needs to be disclosed to the board. Otherwise, there are
ongoing business. As you do business.
Yes, that has to be updated. So, you know, if you're availing of goods from someone, if you have your brother who is earning some sort of a consultancy fee from your company, So those kind of things, you know, are called a related party transaction. And their disclosures with respect to that. Disclosures are also with respect to if I'm a director in one company, if I'm a director in more than one company, then when I sit for the board meeting of my company, I need to disclose that I'm a director in XYZ company as well. For startups, this is perhaps, you know, you wouldn't have that much scenario, but, you know, once you grow, maybe you are directors, or you have directors who are directors in other companies. Some startups sort of, you know, have advisors, consultants who come on the board. Someone will, you know, ask someone's uncle to be a director or to be a director in somewhere else. Those kind of disclosures are also required. So broadly speaking, these are the main sort of compliances that are coming into that are required under the Companies Act. I'm now moving to more sort of practical experiences and funding, sort of what to fund. So any more questions on?
Yes. So right now, we corporated a proprietorship. So what are the documentation or what are the things that I need to take care of while running this proprietorship?
Proprietorship is not recognized in the state. There's no documentation as such. As I said, a company is a separate legal entity. There's a Companies Act, a partnership act is there. Proprietorship, you are individual. So whatever is applicable to an individual, to, you know, you pay your taxes.
So in terms of documentation, in terms of spending, in terms of like what I'm getting or what I'm going to spending. So do I need to keep track of everything?
As a proprietorship, there's no legal requirement apart from what is, you know, a requirement on all of us as individuals. The money that you earn, if it's applicable under tax gamut, you pay those taxes and stuff. Proprietorship, there is no sort of mandatory filing requirement. There's no authority to regulate a proprietor. As an individual, we just do what we are required.
I have a private limited company. In the disclosure part, you said my wife is a partner. She is one of the shareholders. She also has a separate venture of her own. So is that the disclosure? Does it need to be done?
It will at the board meeting. Is she a director?
She is a director.
No, she is, but not the fact that she is a. Are you availing of any services from that company?
It's in a similar sort of.
No, but is there an engagement between the two companies?
Might be in future.
Whenever that engagement comes, it's called related party transaction. So related party working is not a problem. That means there's a transaction between the two entities, or as the word company that is broad enough to use the word, in fact, any arrangement. The moment there's an arrangement, the moment you are paying her fees slash salary slash remuneration slash whatever monetary benefits, that needs to be disclosed at a board meeting, and there's a register that needs to be maintained, that needs to be entered in the register.
Okay, so if we are taking up premises on rent, this fee needs to be
disclosed. One of the most, one of the most, under the previous act, one of the most, controversial part was this rent. Because the previous act used the word, related party in the ordinary course of business. So a lot of companies said, I'm taking on lease, I'm an automobile industry, I'm taking something on lease, this is not my ordinary course of business, so I don't need to disclose this. But there have been now various sort of judgments on saying that even these kind of things need to be disclosed.
But if she is a director, if she is getting salary from this company, that should not be disclosed, or it should
not
be?
No, if there are two entities,
okay,
who are engaged in a contractual relationship or any business relationship, and if one entity has an individual who is related to the individual in this entity, then that needs to be disclosed.
So just to take another scenario. So I'm working as a consultant, I advise companies. Now there are certain aspects wherein even the legal aspect comes into play, because my wife is a lawyer. So now she's not a part of the company. She is working as a legal advisor for the clients directly. In this case, is there a disclosure required?
So
here she's not a part of my
let's
company.
Let's say if we sort of use an example. Let's say you are a part of XYZ private limited.
I am a part of XYZ private limited company. Now I am the company is engaging my wife. As a legal service.
Then there needs to be a disclosure by you on the board of that company saying that the legal advisor is a related party.
Okay. And as an individual, I'm not a part of a client company, but as an individual, I'm doing it. And I'm engaging her as a legal advisor for the client company. So there's no.
There should be a transaction between.
Transaction happening there.
And there should be monitored. So let's hypothetically assume if she's working for free. Most of us don't do that.
Don't work for free.
Let's hypothetically. Even then, I would still advise disclosure. Okay. Is no harm. But my strict interpretation of law, that might not be whether it's for free services for free. But also, in terms of just to use your example, whether a legal advisor will fall under this is some sort of thing, because at least for long back, law was considered a noble profession. So whether it would be a related party transaction or not there were certain sort of clarifications whether lawyers fall under that ambit or not.
Mm-hmm.
But my view has always been there's no harm in disclosing it, particularly for small companies, for private limited companies, for closely held companies. Disclose it, there's no problem in making the disclosures.
As a founder, we mostly focus on product and reaching breaking point and our idea and execution. So at what stage, as per maybe you can suggest, we need to start doing compliances, or maybe you can start thinking about private limited?
Day one.
We can't.
The moment you incorporate a company, your compliance is start. Because if you're non-compliant, no regulator is going to say, he has started just now, I will give him some leave.
I think it doesn't make sense to start a private limited company when you are running a startup. We generally focus on execution and
I would say it makes
sense. Because there are a lot of compliances need to do and you need someone who can.
But
do
sir,
that.
If something goes wrong, I hope nothing goes wrong. Both in a company, you're going to be individually held. The liability will fall on you individually. I would, as I said, there's no right or wrong. If you're comfortable running a proprietorship, and I'm sure if there are three lawyers in the room, two will say start a company, so the other one say go and do it. Different views on that. But my personal view is that incorporate an entity and run your business through that entity.
One more thing. There's never going to be any requirement for funding. So if I know that I'm going to grow only organically or someday, using only my own funds, okay, then is sole proprietorship the right way?
So, see, I'll repeat myself, there's no right way or wrong way. Whatever you're comfortable with.
So, when you say liability, most of the times is, basically monetary, more or less.
Yes, sir. So, if you're confident that if, God forbid, tomorrow liability comes, then you'll be able to settle that. Because the liability will be on individual.
That's right.
It will, in a company, as I keep saying, it comes from the company. Here, your personal assets, not your, any proprietor, even his personal assets are likely to be at a risk, sole proprietorship.
Okay.
So, that those are the calls that, there's no right way or wrong way, there's a way where you're comfortable.
Okay.
Strictly from a legal perspective, I'll always advise have an entity.
No, but then the specific case that I mentioned, so there's no
funding, but the risk,
no
sir.
So I think there an LP would make more sense because it's just,
I would agree that an LLP, but if he's an, you need a partner for that.
No, the only thing is for LLP and for partnership, I mean, what I've studied is that basically the tax slab starts at 30%.
Yeah.
So then if you are a sole individual, you still need that entire
tax. Tax actually, in terms of taxation, sole proprietorship is the best, but you are, you know, then there's an LLP and then there's a corporate company.
Correct.
In the liability, it's the other way around.
Correct.
Also, under the LLP, there's a requirement of having two designated partners, two partners involved in the business. So if you're going to be an individual, those are things that you need to sort of.
So one more thing. Now, how do we decide the share percentage? So, I'm asking you this thing because, for example, if I run a company, okay, and I want to make a wife a part of it, just for the sake of it.
Make your wife 95% share.
Happy woman, huh? But then, no, I'm just asking serious note. So, if I am the person who is being putting all the money into the company, then is there a possibility?
Under law, if I'm putting the money, I need the shares. I should get the shares.
No, but then if I show it as some other, so there can be sweat equity as well, right? So I'm asking.
Ha, but then, so the sweat, even for sweat equity and all, you need to justify the allotments. There's a valuation for sweat equity required under law. So for sweat equity also, you need to justify the valuation that you've done.
So then what is a good way? It's good to have her on board as an employee, or it's good to have her as a partner?
It's good to have her as a partner. But the percentage, I mean, if it's closely held, it's family held, it can work out in any way. What I'm saying is that you cannot, from your individual account, put in an X amount and shares cannot be allotted to your wife. I mean, you can do it, there will be documentation to that with your wife.
For example, if I have a company name, which is a sole proprietorship, if I transfer, there's a different current account for it. Okay, it's a different company name altogether. Okay, I transfer money from my individual account to that account. My wife also puts in some money, but major stake is mine in terms of putting the money. Say 75%, 70% is mine. But I want the structure in such a way that 70% should be held by
her. If it's because between you and your wife, that wouldn't be an issue. If it was you and me, for instance, where I'm a totally not related individual.
Okay.
And you putting money for 70% and allotting me 70%
share. So does there have to be any formal documentation in a sole proprietorship form?
In a sole proprietorship firm, there is no formal document. It's not a vehicle recognized by law.
Even partnership, they say it's not required. How do you...
Partnership is required at least to define your rights and liabilities. How much profit you are going to get and how much loss you are going to get. But in a sole proprietorship, it's not
required.
It's just not a legally recognized vehicle. In a sense, there is no mandatory document.
Okay.
Right now.
Fair enough.